scoot in. I want to welcome all of you all to BT McAllen. I want to welcome all of our family and friends streaming. I am Pastor Nick, one of the pastors on staff here, and I have the awesome opportunity and privilege to share with you from the Word of God this morning. I want to welcome everybody in the overflow. Welcome, welcome, welcome. This is exciting time in the life of our church. I want to also echo what Elder Kevin said. Let us continue to keep our senior pastor in prayer, Pastor Chris, as he mourns the passing of his mother. For those of you who may want to show your love, the funeral services will be Tuesday in the morning in Alice, Texas. And if you would like more information, just visit one of the members on staff. We can pass that information on to you. All right. Y'all ready for the word? Let's continue to worship the Lord in the preaching of the word. If you have your Bibles, and I pray that you do, join me in Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. We're going to read beginning at verse 18. Now, I do want to warn you that after the service that we had at 9 o'clock, I'm pretty charged, and I feel like preaching. And the Cowboys ain't playing, so that means I can preach all I want to. Y'all have nowhere to go. And so this may be a long Sunday. I'm just saying, you know. Matthew chapter 28. Are you at verse 18? All right, it reads like this. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." Bow your heads and pray with me, please. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to worship you through the hearing and preaching of your word. It is my prayer that by the power of your Holy Spirit, the word of God is clearly communicated. It is my prayer that Jesus Christ, the author and finisher of our faith, that he is highly exalted. And it is my prayer that your people are beautifully blessed. In Jesus' name, amen. We are continuing our BT Basic series today. And this is week four, I believe. All my weeks are starting to run together already, and it's the new year. But this is week four, I believe. And we have been laying out in this series, BT Basics, our core beliefs as a church. What do we believe as a church? We want everybody to know that. And one of our BT basics is baptism. BT Church stands for Baptist Temple. And if you have Baptist in your church's name, then chances are baptisms should be important to you. If you are a Baptist church and baptisms are not important to you, chances are you should change your name. Okay? But we here at BT, we have the awesome privilege to see people follow the Lord in obedience by being baptized. We see this almost every month in our church. That is something that we should rejoice and praise God for. Now, baptism plays an important role in the life of the believer. Now, there are some who may ask, what does baptism actually accomplish in the lives of those that take part in it? Now, it is this fundamental question that I'm going to try to answer this morning as we explain why baptism is an important BT basic. As we answer this question, we're going to look at three important aspects of baptism. We're going to look at the method. We're going to look at the meaning. And we're going to look at the motive. We're going to look at the method, the meaning, and the motive. But before we get into those three aspects of baptism, I want to start off early, very early on in the sermon, by stating this. We here at BT, we do not believe that baptism saves anybody. We believe that baptism does not make one justified before God. We believe that you cannot be saved by baptism, because then that would mean you can be saved by works. And we here at BT, we believe that salvation is by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, period. Amen. Amen. We can clap for that. But this brings our question back into view. If baptism does not accomplish anything, then why do we do it? Now, I think that's a fair question, but I don't think that's the correct question. It is not that baptism does not accomplish anything. Okay? I think we should go to the scriptures to see what in fact baptism accomplishes. Okay? It doesn't accomplish justification. It doesn't accomplish salvation. But baptism accomplishes something. The accomplishment of baptism is in the message that it communicates. It is in the sign that it conveys. And it is in the commandment that we get to obey. That is what baptism accomplishes, okay? The accomplishment of baptism is in the message that it communicates, the sign that it conveys, and it is in the commandment that we get to obey. The message that the baptism communicates is the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That just as Jesus was killed and was buried and was resurrected, believers likewise communicate the gospel message in baptism, that our old lives was killed because we are crucified with Christ, that our old lives were buried, but we are resurrected with Christ to walk and live in the newness of life. So baptism communicates the message of the gospel. It is a picture, if you will, of the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is the message that baptism communicates. Baptism conveys the sign of the new covenant. Why is this important? You don't have to turn to Colossians, but trust me, it's there. Colossians chapter 2, the Apostle Paul, he links the old covenant sign of circumcision with the new covenant sign of baptism. Why is this important? It is important because covenants are very important to God. Whenever God would make a covenant with people to promise them something, okay, he would then give them an external sign so that they could look to the sign of the covenant and remember that God keeps his promises. God would give external signs so that his people could remember the promises of God. Because there are some times when God makes promises, there's time that has to pass, and sometimes situations change, and sometimes the circumstance doesn't match the promise that God made you. But God gave them external signs so that when they saw it, they could remember that it was in fact God that made the promise, and it is impossible for God to lie. And if God promises it, he's going to make good on it. For example, Noah. When God destroyed the world by water, after the flood waters receded and Noah could now walk on dry ground, God made Noah a promise. And he said, Noah, guess what? I'm not going to destroy the earth by water again, but fire next time. Just imagine that. God had to promise that because at that point, I mean, every time it rained, Noah might be tempted to run back in the ark. Like, this is going to be a big one again. Come on, y'all. But God promises Noah that, hey, listen, I won't destroy the earth by water again. And to give you an external sign of that covenant, I'm going to put my bow in the sky. And so we see the rainbow is a sign, an external sign of the covenant promises of God. Abraham, he was promised by God that he would make his name great. He was promised by God that he would be the father of many nations. He was promised by God that his descendants would outnumber the number of the sands on the shore and outnumber the stars in the heavens. And at the time when God made this promise to Abraham, Abraham did not have a son. But Eliezer of Damascus was his rightful heir. So the situation and the circumstance did not look like the promise God made to Abraham. But God said to Abraham, this is a sign of our covenant together. I want you to circumcise yourselves. And if you ever doubt the fact that you are in covenant with me, I've given you the external sign of circumcision to let you know that you and me are in covenant together. So just like the external sign of the rainbow and the external sign of circumcision point to the old covenants that God made in the Old Testament, baptism serves as the New Testament's external sign of the covenant that when God promises that for believers who place their faith in Christ Jesus, that he would forgive their sins and take their sins and place them in the sea of forgetfulness, it is an external sign that God will keep that promise. So when the enemy tempts us to despair and tells us of the guilt within, we can look at our baptism and see that that is an external sign that God has in fact made me right with God. That because of Jesus Christ, my sins are forgiven. Baptism is the New Testament sign that we are in covenant relationship with God. Baptism is not only a message to communicate, it's not only a sign to convey, but it is also a commandment that we get to obey. It's a commandment that we get to obey. And this brings us to our text this morning. In Matthew 28, the resurrected Jesus meets with his disciples in Galilee, and he starts off giving them some important information. Now, I love this because we know this text as the Great Commission. I love it because when Jesus starts off with the Great Commission, he doesn't start off with how great the work is. He starts off with how great he is. And he looks at his disciples and he says, "All authority in heaven and on the earth is given to me." Now, this is important. Because if there is a man that is claiming to have all authority in heaven and on earth, chances are he's somebody worth listening to. I love it because when Jesus says that he has all authority, it means that he has, in fact, all authority. He has all power in his hands, not some power, not most power, but all power in his hands. This is very important. You know, I watch documentaries sometimes, and I was watching a documentary one time on carjackers. And no, I'm not looking for another profession. I was looking at a documentary on carjackers. It was a fascinating documentary because they would, you know, they followed the whole process of when they jack your car and they take it to the chop shop and all. I know we don't know nothing about carjacking in the valley, but they did. And there was a reformed carjacker. He had got his life right, so he not jacking cars no more. And he was talking to the host, and he was walking the host through the entire process. He was letting the host know how they would, you know, mark their car, how they would pick them and everything like that. And then he took the host on this street, and he said, every time we jacked a car, we had to make sure that we got on this street. The reason why this street is important is because this street is the fastest route to the next state. He said it's the fastest route to the next state. And there's sometimes we would be involved in high speed chase and we would get on this street and it's the fastest route to the next state. And right when we cross state lines, the authorities, they couldn't follow us because this was out of their jurisdiction. And so he said, we made a killing doing this. But listen, when Jesus says all authority in heaven and on earth is given to me, what Jesus is in fact saying is this, that there is nowhere in the universe that is outside my jurisdiction. That if we get enough technology and enough money to go and colonize Mars, Jesus says, guess what? I am even lower there. And so he sets them up with how great he is, and he lets them know. All authority has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them. So we see that making disciples and baptism is linked together. What does that mean? That we are commanded to make disciples. And if we are commanded to make disciples, then we are also commanded to baptize. So a church that is following Jesus, if we are going to make disciples, we have also got to take baptism very seriously. What are you trying to say, Pastor Nick? I'm trying to say this, that wherever disciples are being made, baptism should be happening. And by God's grace, we get to experience baptisms on a monthly basis, which tells you that you are a part of a church that is in fact making disciples. Amen. We can rejoice to God for that. Now let's turn our attention to the method. The method of baptism found in the scripture is to immerse. Baptism by immersion is the method that is found in the scriptures. Baptism comes from a Greek word. To baptize comes from a Greek word meaning to immerse. And when we look at how Jesus was baptized in Mark chapter 1, verse 9, he was immersed in the water. Scripture says, and when he came up out of the water, you cannot come up out of something that you did not go down in. So Jesus was dipped in the water. He was immersed in the water. We also see that the church in Acts practiced baptism by immersion. Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch in Acts chapter 8, verse 36, we see after the Ethiopian eunuch comes to believe the gospel and he trusts Jesus Christ as his Savior, he says, hey, Philip, it's water right here. Can I be baptized? Philip said, yeah. And immediately they go and they are baptized. And the scripture says, when they came up out of the water. You cannot come up out of something that you did not go down in. We also see that the early church practiced baptism by immersion. The African church father Tertullian of Carthage is quoted as saying, "We are immersed," and he made this quote in AD 200. This is very important because the picture of baptism, remember, it communicates the message of the gospel, that believers are buried with Christ and also raised with Christ. And if you mess up the method, you can mess up the picture. Are y'all with me? Now, I know some people are talking about, well, what about people who can't be immersed? I know that there are countries and there are some places and some contexts where people cannot be immersed. Well, what about them? I believe God's grace is with them, and however they can get the job done, they can get the job done. But that is not the case for 100% of the people in this room, because we got a pool right there. Amen. I'll never forget it. Pastor Chris was telling me about a time of a lady. She was on her deathbed and she wanted to hear and believe the gospel. So a minister was, somebody called the church and a minister was sent out. It was Pastor Chris. And he went and prayed with this lady. She believed the Lord Jesus, and she wanted to get baptized, but she was bedbound. She couldn't get immersed. So Pastor Chris got some towels, and he Super Bowled her. I think you can do that. You know, when they win the Super Bowl and they do that. It's a new term. Made it up just now. Super Bowled her. You know, when you win and they do that. But that's what he did. Now, guess what? She physically could not get immersed. I believe God's grace is there. And guess what? I believe God recognizes that. But like I said, that is not the case with 100% of the people in this room. My soul was so excited last year when our dear sister wanted to obey the Lord in baptism. She was physically unable to go up those stairs. But like the Ethiopian eunuch, she said, that pool isn't the only place where we have water. We got water over there in the pool by the pavilion. And Pastor Marshall baptized her and her family right there in that pool. And guess what? She's in a wheelchair, but she was immersed. Now notice what we did not say. We did not say baptism by submersion, because submersion means you put them down and you may not bring them back up. I know some pastors that want to practice baptism like that. Not me. I want to bring you back up. I bring them back up 100% of the time. But this is the biblical method. John the Baptist chose where he baptized by the Jordan River specifically because it had a lot of water there. And he wanted to immerse people in the water. This is important because the method of baptism by immersion, it communicates the saving work of Christ at Calvary. It also communicates his resurrection from the dead, and it communicates the awesome glorification of the believer that placed his trust in him. So that is the method. And at BT, we practice baptism by immersion. Now let's take our attention from the method to look at the meaning. The meaning of baptism is identity. Baptism shows that we identify with Christ Jesus. Baptism shows that we identify with Christ Jesus. Jesus tells them, Matthew 28:19, go therefore make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. We are baptizing people because they are now identifying with God. This is important. Flip with me to Romans chapter 6. Y'all doing okay?
Yeah.
All right. Romans chapter 6, verse 3 says this: do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. Verse 4, for if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. And baptism shows that we identify and we are now united with Christ Jesus. I believe this is one reason why the enemy fights people so hard to follow the Lord in obedience to baptism, because the enemy doesn't want people to identify with Jesus. Because if you identify with Jesus, then that means that there is nothing in heaven and on the earth that can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. The enemy knows that for those who identify with Jesus, death, hell, the grave, nothing can stop the believer. And that the end of the day, victory always belongs to people who identify with Jesus. At the end of the day. This is why when Stephen, when he was being stoned, this is why he's not scared, he's not crying, he's looking up to heaven because he understands he identifies with Jesus. The enemy doesn't want that. I believe it's important to identify with Jesus because he is the one that has all authority in heaven and on earth. If there's anybody that you want to identify with, surely it should be people that have some authority. Amen. I mean, I get it. I'm going to just say it how I feel it and address the elephant in the room. And if it's not the elephant in the room, it's probably the elephant in my mind. But either way, I'm going to get it out, and then we're going to keep going. This past Friday, we got to witness the inauguration of the 45th president of these United States of America. We got to witness. Hear what I'm saying? Y'all might want to stop clapping. Y'all don't know what I'm about to say next. I'm joking. It's gospel. Don't worry. We got to witness peaceful transition of power. Listen, that is something we should thank God for because I know missionaries and pastors who live in context where they don't get to experience peaceful transition of power. They don't get to experience that. Regardless of how you feel about the outcome, okay? Whether your guy won or lost or whatever, the fact that we get to witness peaceful transition of power in this country is something that we should thank God for, okay? Now, I'm not talking about the outcome. That's a whole nother sermon on a whole nother day, okay? But I will say this. And the reason why I'm saying this is because I feel this burning in my heart. That just because we have somebody in office that may appear to be sympathetic and ready to flow with Christian ideals, it does not mean that we have a pass to sleep on the job. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Because Jesus didn't call the White House to make disciples. He called the church to make disciples. Are y'all with me? So we can cheer, we can rah-rah, but guess what? We need to make disciples. And when Jesus called us to make disciples, he said, baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, which means that he's not telling us to baptize people in the American dream. He's telling us to baptize people in the name of Jesus. We don't want people to just identify with country. We want people to identify with kingdom. Are y'all with me? See, we're not clapping on that, but I think that's something we need to clap for. Because at the end of the day, when every government falls, the kingdom and the King Jesus will keep standing. And I want to identify with that. Amen. That's who I want to identify with. Amen. And so baptism shows that we, in fact, identify, here it is, with Jesus. I want to identify with Jesus. Baptism also shows that we have been cleansed, that the very core of who we are has been cleansed by God. That's what it shows. And in 1 Peter, it deals with this, and it lets us know that our conscience has been cleansed. And not just cleansed with the ceremonial washing of the body, but our souls have been cleansed by the sacrificial blood of Jesus Christ, which means this. Whenever my heart or whenever the circumstances or situation around me try to communicate that I'm not clean, I'm not right before God, I don't know the Lord. Whenever the enemy tries to convince me otherwise, I can look at my baptism and see that, guess what? No. God will keep his promise to finish the work that he began in me. I am clean. So not only do we identify with Jesus, not only are we cleansed, but baptism means that we will identify with Jesus in his persecution. See, we don't want that. We want the blessing, but we don't want the persecution. But when you are baptized, it means that I identify with Jesus, the good, bad, and ugly. I identify with Jesus and his persecution. You know, Jesus said in John 15, I don't want y'all to think I make it up, so I'm going to let y'all turn there. Turn there with me. John chapter 15, verse 20, this is what Jesus says. Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. Skip down to verse 21. This is what Jesus says. But all these things they will do to you on account of my name. Jesus says you're going to face persecution like I faced persecution. But it's not about you, it's about me. They're going to do it to you because you bear my name. You identify with me. They're going to persecute you on account of my name. So that means this, that when we are baptized, it doesn't communicate that I am just a follower of Jesus when it is convenient. It means that I am a follower of Jesus if the entire world and the government turns against me. I'm still going to follow Jesus. If my family turns their back on me, I'm still going to follow Jesus. Now, when I talk to people about being baptized, this aspect of identifying with Jesus and persecution is probably perhaps the biggest barrier to people being baptized when I deal with it. When I talk to people who have been baptized as babies and they have not been baptized since they were a follower of Christ, and we talk about this. This is the biggest barrier that I run into. Because some fear the persecution or backlash that they will receive when they break from tradition. Are y'all with me? And because of that fear, it says to me, that you are more comfortable not disappointing people. And you would rather disobey Jesus than disappoint family. Are y'all with me? Because here it is. When we identify with Jesus, it means that we will identify with persecution. And I'm not talking about for everybody, but the people that I come in contact with, this is the biggest barrier to them being baptized after they profess faith in Christ Jesus, because they were baptized according to tradition and not according to the word. And if I break from tradition, I don't know what grandma gonna say or the family, or they already think I'm stuck up because I go down to that BT anyway. I know. But here it is. Who do you live to please? And if you face persecution from your family, but you are accepted by God, where's the loss? And could it be that your failure to obey Jesus in this area is a tool that the enemy is using? Because you're more willing to stand up for tradition than the word of God. This is a tool that the enemy is using to block your family from seeing and believing the gospel. I don't know. Pastor Marshall, I knew it would get quiet when we would rest on this point right here. But see, our baptism shows that we identify with Jesus, and we identify with Jesus first. That it's not about our family background. It's not about our country of origin. It's not about our political party. It's not about our racial identity or our cultural identity. When we are baptized, we are saying, I am baptized and I identify with Jesus first. Amen. Pastor Charlie Dates, man, I gotta fly. Pastor Charlie Dates, he pastors a church, an old church in Chicago. In March of this year, BT will be 32 years old. Pastor Charlie Dates' church will be 100 years old in like 2 years. So this is an old church. When Pastor Charlie became the pastor of his church, he was 30, his wife was 29, and the head deacon told him, by you joining our church, you've just brought the median age of our church down to 55. So that, I'm saying that so we can see how old the church was. Well, Pastor Date said, you know, in dealing with an older congregation, one of the words of wisdom that he received was, listen, man, don't make too many changes too soon. That's good words of wisdom for any pastor. And but Pastor Date said he had to do something so that he could attract, you know, more 30-year-old people to his church. So he got the church behind that. They wanted some more people in the church, right? And so they said they were going to have to renovate. They were going to have to change up the look a little bit. Well, one of the barriers to the renovation was an 8-foot grand piano on the platform of the church. And so this is a big deal, the 8-foot grand piano, because it was a sacred cow for some folks. Like, some folks feel like the spirit can't move unless a piano on stage. I know we don't know nothing about that, Nitty. We don't know nothing about that here. So Pastor Date said the piano, you know, because people think King David played on the piano, you know. They feel, you know, they think it's, you know. So he said he had to get rid of the piano, but he couldn't just get rid of the piano. So he had to do it in stages. So he said he moved it to the basement. And he said that took a little while. He said he didn't face much backlash behind that. He said, but the piano, it was old. It was out of tune. They kept trying to tune it. They would tune it. It would get back out of tune. And it became more of a headache than, you know, than they wanted to. So Pastor Date said, you know, he wanted to move into the next phase of getting rid of the piano. So he called in companies to see what he could get for the piano or how he could move it. And so he said one company came in and told him, they looked at the piano and they told him, well, Pastor Dates, we could give you this brand new piano and then we'll put some money on top of it and we can get you right. And so he said, okay. He brought in another quote. And then the guy said, yeah, we'll give you this brand new model piano and we'll give you some money on top and then we'll set you straight. And Pastor Day said after about the third person told him they're going to give him a brand new piano and put money on top, he realized that they knew something that he didn't know. So he said, well, let me just call the people that made the piano. So he called Steinway and the Steinway ladies came to the church and he said they played it, they flipped up the hood, they looked underneath it, you know. He said they did everything and they looked at Pastor Dates and they said, what do you want to do? And Pastor Dates said, well, really, I'm trying to get rid of this piano. Stay with me, we're going somewhere. He said, really, I'm trying to get rid of the piano, but what can y'all do for me? And the Steinway lady said, well, we can fix it. And he said, well, how much? And he said, they gave him a number that no man could number. He said, they gave him a number that he couldn't stomach that. And so the ladies said, well, Pastor, if you aren't going to fix it, what are you going to do with it? And he said, y'all trying to pay me to keep the piano. You said, y'all want me to pay to keep the piano to get it fixed. He said, people are trying to pay me to get rid of the piano. And so the lady said, people trying to pay you to get, what are they trying to do? So Pastor Date showed them the brand new models of the piano and the money that they wanted to offer on top of the piano. He said, finally, the ladies just chewed him out and said, Pastor, what are you doing? He said it was at that moment he realized that they knew something that he didn't know. They said, Pastor Dates, what are you doing? They said, Pastor Dates, do you know what you have here? He said, one lady lifted up the hood of the piano. She said, Pastor Dates, read the name of the plaque in that piano. He said, it says Steinway. She says, exactly. We only make 5 of these a year. She says, and you're getting ready to trade this priceless piano for a cheap new edition. She said, the value of this piano is not in the condition that it's in. The value of this piano is in the name that's on the inside. And see, when we are baptized in Christ Jesus, our value is not in our family, not in our race, not in our country, but our value is found in the name that is on the inside. So if we fail to obey the Lord in baptism, what we are in fact saying is this: I don't want to identify with Jesus. I would rather identify with something cheap. Now hear me. I'm not calling our families cheap. I'm not calling our cultures cheap. But compared to the kingdom of God, there is no comparison. Man, I gotta fly. All right. The motive of baptism. The motive of baptism is I believe. What are you trying to say, Pastor Nick? I'm trying to say this, that people that declare I believe are people who qualify for baptism. It was after believing that the Ethiopian was baptized. The early church would not baptize you until after you believe. Why is this important? Because believers have a strong desire to obey Jesus. Believers have a strong desire to love Jesus. And what did Jesus say in John 14, 15? Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. So believers are motivated to be baptized. And I believe this, that we as believers should desire to obey Christ in all things. As believers in Christ, we declare this: I believe, therefore I obey. Now, there may be some of you here today, you were baptized as a baby. You have not been baptized since you profess faith in Christ. I want to encourage your heart. I don't want us to say ouch without healing, okay? I want to encourage you today. If you walk out these doors right now, we are ready to baptize right now today. The Ethiopian, immediately after he was saved, he said, guess what? It's water right here. Can I be baptized right here? And guess what? I'm going to say like the Ethiopian, it's water right here. What is stopping you from obeying the Lord Jesus Christ in baptism? There's some people that say, I want to know your will for my life, God. God, I want you to open up your word to me. I want you to reveal to me your plan. And why would God tell you more if you're going to disregard this basic command to be baptized as a believer? Why would he open up more? And we can't even obey him in baptism. Now, I know some people are thinking, well, what about the thief on the cross? I'm so glad you asked about the thief on the cross. Because guess what? The thief on the cross, he was where? On the cross. He ain't had time to be baptized. And he's with Jesus right now. But I know this to be true. About 100% of the people in this room, you are not the thief on the cross. Not only are you not the thief on the cross, but you have now. And you have water. Will you obey the Lord in baptism? I want to stress this. I want to stress this. Baptism is not necessary for salvation. But baptism is necessary to obey Christ. And if you're here today, you're saying, listen, I've been wanting to do this for a long time. At 9 a.m., we baptized a man who said he's been wanting to be baptized for 15 years. And today he got up, followed the Lord in baptism. And it is my prayer that as we prepare for this altar call, that people who believe in Christ Jesus, that love Jesus with all of their heart, soul, mind, and strength, that they would come up and walk in obedience and follow the Lord in baptism. That's what we're praying. We've been praying that all week as a staff because we believe it's important. And we believe it is important because Jesus commanded us to make disciples. And in making disciples, he says, guess what? You are to baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So I want you to stand on your feet. And as the ministers come, I have a few invitations today. My first invitation is for those who know that they don't trust Jesus as their Lord and Savior. If you don't trust Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the scripture says this, that if you call upon the name of the Lord, you will be saved. If you will confess with your mouth and believe in your heart the Lord Jesus, the scripture says that you will be saved. So if you are here and you are not a follower of Jesus, guess what? You can be now. So that is the first invitation. Come. Now you may ask, well, what's next after I follow Jesus? I'm so glad you asked. What's next is the baptismal pool. And we have ministers ready to receive you right now. My second invitation is for those of us who are in Christ Jesus, who have been going through a rough time. We have been going through a time where life is really putting a squeeze on us, and it doesn't feel like the promises of God will come to pass. I want you to come and connect with one of our ministers, so that we can pray with you, so that we can remind you of the victory that you possess because you identify with Jesus. Come up here now. My third invitation is for those who are struggling with addictions and troubled relationships. We have, amen, praise the Lord for coming, brother. Amen, let's rejoice for that. Thank you, Jesus. My third invitation is for those who are struggling with addictions and struggling with bad relationships, struggling with habits, and you're trying to be on the road to recovery. We have a ministry here for you called H2O. And it's a community of people committed to looking like Jesus Christ. We want to walk with you. That group meets every Thursday night. And if you would like more information about H2O, come up here, see one of our ministers, or visit us in the info center. Let's pray as we respond to God. Heavenly Father, we give you this time. We ask you, God, that you would move on the hearts of your people so that we can respond in obedience to you. Lord, I thank you for moving on the hearts of people right now who are going to obey you by being baptized right now. And I ask you, God, that as you continue to make us new and conform us into your image, I ask you, God, that you would give us the grace to continue to walk in the newness of life. In Jesus' name.